Listening Library presents The Gospel According to Larry by Janet Tashjian. Read for you by Jesse Eisenberg.
A note to the reader. While I was waiting in line at the local grocery store, a young man approached me and asked me for the time. I told him 4:10. I remember it distinctly, and continued emptying my carriage onto the conveyor belt. He hovered around the store's exit and approached me again as I left. He held a copy of my first novel, True Confessions.
Aren't you a writer?
I told him I was.
I've got a great story for you.
Oh yeah? I pushed the shopping cart toward my car. You know who the best person to tell your story is? He shook his head. You. He smiled, then offered me a bundle of typed pages held together with twine. It looked like a thesis, but smelled like the bottom of the earth. I didn't take it. There are lots of great publishing houses out there. I'd start in New York. You can always go the agent route, too. I finished loading the groceries into my car, then gave him my best nice-to-meet-you smile.
You don't understand. I'm not even supposed to be here.
I closed the trunk and looked at him. Blonde hair, half grown out into its natural brown. Serious eyes, slight build, peaceful smile. 17, 18 years old. He looked vaguely familiar.
This has to get published.
He pressed the papers into my hand.
I don't know what else to do.
He stood on one leg, the other one bent and tucked against it. It was a yoga position my son and I practiced all the time. Tree pose? He nodded.
I'm trying to stay balanced.
Aren't we all? He seemed completely unself-conscious.
I just came back from Walden Pond. You ever been there?
Many times. He pulled the paperback Walden from his back pocket and started to read.
To be a philosopher is not merely to have subtle thoughts, nor even to found a school, but so to love wisdom as to live according to its dictates, a life of simplicity, independence, magnanimity, and trust.
He looked at me, eyes shining.
Isn't that the best?
What do you say to a kid standing on one leg while quoting Thoreau? I told him I'd read his manuscript.
I set it up like a term paper, typed it on an old manual typewriter in the woods. Then I pulled stuff from the web, added some biblical quotes.
He smiled.
It'll all make sense. You'll see.
He placed his foot firmly on the ground.
If you decide not to help me, I'll understand.
I asked how I should contact him.
That's impossible. I'll contact you.
On the drive home, I skimmed through the pages on my lap. I sat in my driveway and continued to read, unfazed by the gallon of ice cream melting in my trunk. I thought he looked familiar. I raced back to the grocery store to find him, but he had already gone. By the time he called the next day, I had read his entire manuscript.
Well?
His anticipation reminded me so much of my own, waiting to get my first novel published. I told him I had another project I was working on, but thought his version of the story was important and needed to be told. I asked my editor, Christy, if she'd be interested in publishing the manuscript. After reading it, she was. Josh also gave me a disc with photos he'd taken. We placed them throughout the book. The epilogue was my idea, to add another perspective. Working on the book, I sometimes found Josh's story inspirational. Other times, it seemed eerie and devoid of meaning. In my research, I found some people who said Josh suffered from bipolar disorder or ADHD. One teacher even said he thought Josh had an acute messiah complex. All I know is, the young man I met several times over the course of a month seemed perfectly normal. But don't go by me. I sit in a room and make up stories all day. When my editor mailed me the galleys a few months ago, I talked to Josh for the last time. You realize if we publish this, people will know you're still alive, I said. The whole mess might start up again. His voice sounded calm and rational.
It's really important for me to be honest right now. I just want to write about the truth.
I tried to reach him later to give him some copies of the book, but he disappeared. Again, this is his story. Janet Tashjian.
The Gospel According to Larry, in my own words, by Josh Swensen. Part 1. This is the disciple which testifieth of these things, and wrote these things. And we know that his testimony is true. St. John 21:24. I haven't enjoyed a rant this much since Thoreau, Beth said. Footnote. Henry David Thoreau wrote Walden and Civil Disobedience. We had to read them for English last semester. Very New England. Nature is good, materialism is bad. Beth ate it up with a spoon. We need people stirring up the way we think about things. My best friend Beth was trying to talk me into forming a Larry study group with her. His website, www.thegospelaccordingtolarry.com, received hundreds of hits a day, mostly from teens and college students. No one knew Larry's identity, and that conjecture alone was the source of several companion websites. Many kids at school were fans, but Beth was rabid. Josh, I know neither one of us has ever joined a club in our life, she said, but that's precisely why we should. I tried to listen to the details of her story. I really did, but there is something about Beth's mouth that gets in the way of paying attention to its contents. Footnote. She would hate me for saying this with her don't objectify me rant. Protest all you want, Beth. It's the truth. She often wore a certain brown lipstick and outlined the edges of her lips with this pencil she carried in her bag. Every time she talked, it was like this pale chocolate snow cone staring up at me, waiting to be eaten. I've been in love with her since sixth grade, but she didn't have a clue. I'll help you with the club, I said, but just so the two of us can bag all the meetings and laugh at the other people who show up. She wasn't amused. This isn't a joke. Someone is finally talking about the things I've been saying all along, and I think it's important to help spread the word. Are you in or are you out? Of course I'm in. I can't let you do this on your own. Next thing I know, you'll be running for prom queen or something. She punched me in the arm, her usual form of affection. Hey, why don't you help me at the store this afternoon? We're having a run on shovels. Beth's father's hardware store had been our work, treehouse, summer camp since grammar school. Sorting the nuts and bolts, counting the different light bulbs, shoveling the wood chips into wheelbarrows had never seemed like a job to either of us. The small store prided itself on carrying everything a homeowner could need, but for a loner like me, it was a non-threatening way to be part of the community without too much social pressure. I told Beth I'd meet her there at 4. For a brief moment, I pretended we were a couple, not snowbound outside Boston, but romping through the Caribbean surf, tan and in love. My fantasy shattered, however, when she waved goodbye and headed across the cafeteria to Todd Terrific, a new jock she was obsessed with. Can someone please explain to me how this preoccupation with dopey athletes happens even to headstrong young women who work in hardware stores and score 1350s on their SATs? Beth, what are you doing to me? Life was cruel and unfair. What did this Larry guy have to say about that? The rest of school went by like the movie Groundhog Day, where Bill Murray wakes up and every day is the same down to the last boring details. Even when something new did happen, fire drill, substitute teacher, it was still just a giant yawn in the storyline. To keep myself amused during study hall, I invented a new alphabet based on the sense of smell. Footnote. I also wrote a skit for Monty Python in case they ever wanted to reunite, then drew sketches for the Gumby art project I was working on. Gotta keep busy, I always say. At home that night, I booted up my laptop and logged on. I checked my email, then the small portfolio of stocks my mother left me when she died. I made one last online stop. To Larry. I wondered if Beth was doing the same thing at the same time. An unrequited cyberdate. The Larry logo filled the screen. A peace sign with a dove, a floppy disk, a planet, and a plug inside each of its four sections. I scrolled down through several photographs to comments people had written that day. Puljon posted a new link to Adbusters. Tojam ranted about Larry's last sermon, calling it brilliantly flawed. I was in the middle of reading his argument when Peter knocked quickly, then stuck his head in my room. Want some leftover pizza? My stepfather was the ultimate businessman. Even in his terry cloth robe and slippers with the squashed heels, he could command his advertising consulting firm from the brink of failure to unbridled success. He had the whole sales thing down, the firm handshake, the warm smile, the good listening. It was the real Peter, not put on like lots of other guys at his company. He looked over my shoulder and checked out the screen. I've heard about this, Larry, he said. Some guy bashing our culture online. Anonymous coward. Some people think it's one of the big televangelists trying to reach the teen market. Or maybe it's a bored housewife in the suburbs looking for something to do. Peter shook his head. Probably some hacker trying to make a name for himself. I'll add that to the list of hypotheses, I said. You do that. He handed me a slice of pizza on a paper towel. Dinner at Catherine's tomorrow. That okay with you? Sure. Great. Catherine was my stepfather's girlfriend who had been putting on the full court press to be the next Mrs. Swensen. I didn't have the nerve to tell Peter I found her as interesting as a bag of rice. Peter closed the door and headed downstairs to his office. I browsed the Larry archives, then printed out the latest sermon to prepare for Beth tomorrow. Sermon number 93. Slip on your Gap jeans, your Nike t-shirt, your Reeboks, or maybe even your Cons if you think that makes you cool and ironic in a Kurt Cobain kind of way. Grab your Adidas backpack, ride to school on your Razor, drink your Poland Spring, eat your Power Bar, write a paper on your iMac, slip on your Ralph Lauren windbreaker, buy the latest CD from Tower, check the caller ID to see who's on your phone, eat your Doritos, drink your Coke, stare at the TV till you're stupefied. Is there any time of the day when we're not being used and abused by the advertising companies?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.